Hello, Schmoville. This is the debut of our show, Phase 3 on the Toadhop Network. This is a monumental show for what the show is now. Had this version, this phase of the podcast never happened, I don't know if we'd still have a show. But we did. We went from having Phase 2, our show was getting a lot of listeners, and you guys were chiming in a lot. We were having a really good time during the Phase 1. Schmoville. Oh, you want to say hi to Schmoville? Sure. Say hi, Schmoville.
Hey, Snow.
What's going on, brother?
What's going on,
Vitter? I'm just going to finish talking to Schmoville. So, phase three, what happened was that Mark was doing a show with a guy that would become the Wild Man, Josh McCouga, and the very lovely Justine Marino, a show called Three's Too Much. It was happening on the Toadhop Network. And during that time, we were looking for a new place to do the podcast. So Frank Kramer over at Toadhop had heard the show, really liked what we were doing, and asked us to be on board for Toadhop. And so the great relationship began. We started off with a great one. Mark and I started the show.
I want some ice.
You want some ice? All right, we'll get you some ice in a second. All right. So I'm going to get her some ice. You guys listen to this show. It's a good one. Jay Harrington, who was one of the guys in American... We are. I guess I'd tell them about American Reunion, because that was a movie that you'll never be watching. But it was a movie that had just come out, and Jay Harrington was one of the guys in that movie. He's a guy I knew for a long time. He came in. We talked to Catherine Reitman on the phone about the new director of Hunger Games had just signed on. So anyway, it was a really cool episode. Catherine called in. She wasn't live in studio, but it was awesome because it was the first time we ever did the show live, and it was, well, you know, in this way. And then 9 a.m. was the time. It was a morning show to start, so that's kind of bizarre as well. So enjoy the first show, and if you want to watch this episode on Toadhop, you can do it. The link is below. If you want to watch the actual live video, this is the audio version, but if you want to watch the whole video, the link is in the description. Check it out and enjoy the beginning of Phase 3.
Live from Universal Studios Hollywood in beautiful Los Angeles, California.
ToadhopNetwork.com.
Radio worth watching.
Radio worth watching.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Schmoes Know Podcast. Hey, Mark, how you doing, pal?
I'm doing well. That music sounds good to hear again.
It sounds different, but great.
I don't know where that song came from.
Eddie Murphy's closet somewhere.
It's like a really dirty porno or a really clean snuff film. That's what that soundtrack is.
I'm okay with either one. guys, listen, this is very different. For the Schmoville people out there watching right now, you can see us in video, and that's new right off the bat. Well, at least it's new and not looking like a snuff film, like you said.
And it's pretty horrific, too. I'm sorry. This is how we actually look. We don't have our makeup on. I'm not wearing my hat. I don't have anything. I'm completely unprepared this morning.
That's okay. Now, here's the thing.
Welcome to the Toadhop Network, buddy.
Well, that was the thing. Thank you so much. I'm actually, you're like a seasoned vet at this point.
Yeah, I'm kind of a god when I walk in. They throw rose petals and it's kind of like the entrance.
That wasn't roses.
In the Hunger Games, that wasn't roses?
No. It was the thorns, for sure.
And we're live on the Toadhop Network from Universal Studios, dude.
That's the cool thing. Yeah. We're walking up here and we're looking at all the, I think like Terminator was blasting in the back and whatnot, and we're like, this is where we're supposed to do our podcast.
When you go to Universal Studios, you can either go on the Back to the Future ride, you can go on the Jaws ride, or you can watch the Schmoes do a podcast.
That's right. And so,
anything gets your heart rate up.
Well, it's talking about getting your heart rate up. When we started this podcast, it was like
way back in the early 60s, I want to say.
Or a year ago. It was just about a year ago, and our first guest was Katie Sackhoff. And we had, I think the sound equipment equivalent to a bad karaoke machine.
We were plugging stuff into a light bright.
It was not great. With our good buddy Cheese at the time.
Our producer Cheese.
And things kind of picked up. We got another producer. And then, because of the support from Schmoville and from the support of all the fans and everything that was kind of going on, the great guests that we've had, we are now, like you said, Mark, at the Toadhop Network.
Because of you guys, because of you, the fans, I now have a big microphone in front of my face, and it projects all across the world. That's kind of nerve-wracking now that I think about it.
Yeah, so now I know that you guys are to blame for that. that being said, we're super excited to be here. We're going to be doing a lot of stuff, and the questions that have been coming in is, what about Catherine Reitman? Is Catherine Reitman joining you guys?
Catherine Reitman, who is the third wheel on our podcast. I'm kind of the third wheel, I guess.
You're the third wheel anytime you go anywhere.
She was kind of we picked her up kind of a mid-season kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then she was a regular on the podcast, so she's shooting right now, a show for VH1, but she will be here shortly. Coming in and out. She'll be here, not today, but she'll be here in some weeks. She'll be good, in some weeks we'll miss her, but maybe she'll call in.
Well, yeah, she got a show on VH1 where she's she's like interviewing, I don't know, I think it's, who's Willis? What's his name? Todd Bridges?
Todd Bridges,
I think she interviews him every week. No,
former celebrities.
The former celebrities, and she's very busy, and, of course, and if you guys are familiar with the Schmo Show, then you're familiar probably with Breaking It Down as well. So yes, Catherine will be back next week for sure.
But what do we do on this podcast, buddy?
A lot of good stuff, man.
We talk movies. That's what we do. This is the movie show on Toadhop.
There's a lot of good stuff coming out on the Schmo Snow podcast today. Now, one of the things we were going to open with, but because of traffic in L.A. is so horrific, Jay Harrington, who is one of the leads in American Beauty, or had like he was Mina Suvari's boyfriend. In the new American Reunion,
Mina Suvari's character was with Chris Klein in the first couple, and then you know, the things happen, Kristian. People change, people move away, people have dreams, and she went with Jay Harrington instead.
And who's not a bad looking dude?
So, well, yeah, I mean, so, you know,
when you see him
for yourself, yeah, I'm sure he's a good looking dude in person.
So you'll see when he comes in, Ellis is going to be very, he's going to be stumbling over his words. And but the thing is, we're waiting.
I don't fidget when handsome guys come on the podcast.
I don't know. I saw you when Tom Arnold was there. Now, the thing is, when you know, we're gonna talk about to Jay once he gets here. We'll talk about the process of how he got involved and him kind of going to guest type, because he's a super nice guy and he played like a douchey guy in that.
Yeah,
but. So what we'll talk about now is there's a lot of movie stories out there, and Mark and I just did a video. You guys know, you may or may not know if you're listening for the first time to Schmoes No Podcast, I am a big Hunger Games fan. I am proud to say it. It's fine. More of the books than the movie. But there's a lot of stories going on with Gary Ross.
Gary Ross directed the first Hunger Games movie, which was my intro to the world of the Hunger Games. I didn't read the books.
What was the last book you read? That wasn't Van Halen.
That's tough. That's going way. That's like Animal Farm in 10th grade. Like, I read the George Orwell, and I'm like, this is enough reading for me. Yeah. Animals talking.
Yeah, right. Well, you can't wait for that movie, I'm sure. Gary Ross won't be directing that either. Now, Gary Ross.
What's the deal with your boy? He directed the first Hunger Games, Gary Ross, and then he dropped out, right?
Let's go and say that he was my boy before I saw the movie. Because not that I disliked the movie. I thought it was a well-made movie. There was a lot missing from the film. And I thought his shaky cam stuff and all that, you know, Doug Liman stuff that he was doing.
Yeah.
Didn't work for the movie. I thought
so he's
he lost
not your boy anymore. He's more like a distant nephew.
I like what he did. He introduced everybody. He made one of the most profitable movies, you know, in a long time. But the difference
Christian
now.
Christian Harloff doesn't care about profits. Okay, if Christian Harloff cared about profits, he'd be a huge Michael Bay fan.
I like when you talk about me when I'm not here. So yeah, the thing with him is that they said, well, I don't know, they asked him for too much money or this and that. He doesn't know if he needs to continue. The guy's made like 5 movies, I think, in like 20 years or something. So.
Yeah.
He's officially now not coming back.
Okay.
Which opens up the discussions of who could be the director to take on Catching Fire, the Empire Strikes Back of the Hunger Games.
Well, wasn't he kind of wavering for a minute, though? Didn't he say, yeah, I'm not going to come back? Then he's like, ah, well, maybe I'll come back.
He was on vacation in, like, Hawaii, and everyone was going back and forth saying, oh, he's not doing it. He's like, what are you talking about? I'm swimming in the pool with my daughter. Leave me alone. But, yeah, so he's not. He came back, and he's like, look, I'm not. He's not going to do it. So who would you want to see as the director of Catching Fire?
Well, there's a few directors out there. First of all, this is not death to the franchise. So I don't want Hunger Games fans going crazy, like, oh no, we're losing our franchise because Harry Potter had a bunch of different directors.
Yeah.
The Star Wars, the original trilogy had
sure
3
did.
Different directors.
Yep.
Even your favorite franchise, Twilight, has had a couple different directors.
Well,
so, you know,
who directed the last one? Carrot Top?
There's guys that he was great, by the way. There is guys that I want to see, but there's more guys that I just don't want to see touch the franchise. You know, when you get to guys, when you get to names like Michael Bay,
right.
or you get to like Stephen Sommer or
right.
something like that, I just don't want somebody to ruin it because I'm kind of interested in the movie now.
Right.
I'm interested in the lineage, the lore.
And that's what I think it did, though, for a lot of non-book fans like yourself. It made you interested. It didn't define the world well enough.
I was kind of confused.
But
I don't really understand why we're even having a Hunger Games. I wanted more background as to why this is even going on.
Well, we're not doing a whole Hunger Games podcast, because I
Thank
can get into
goodness.
That. Yeah, all right. But,
Kenny Knapsack for that one.
I'd like to see Alfonso Cuarón, who is, you know, the director of Children of Men, and he directed the third Harry Potter and Y Tu Mamá También.
That rolled off your tongue.
Well, I'm a fan.
You've lived in Los Angeles for a long time, haven't you?
It's very true. I went on a date back then. That's how long ago
he
that
directed
thing was.
This and this and Mama Tobian.
I do Mama Tobian. And so I'd like to see him because I think he'd bring a kind of darker edge to it. And Lionsgate will not make it a rated R, but they should. So I know Lionsgate is listening right now.
Yeah.
Make it rated R.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, we're going to put this out there.
Yeah,
I think we should go ahead and put this out there. If you want to talk Hunger Games, if you want to talk to Jay Harrington later, if you want to talk to the Schmoes, you can do that. You can call us up here at Toadhop. You can talk to us live. The number to call is 888-520-4374.
But wait, don't call in just yet because we won't be taking calls yet. So just wait.
I got the button, dude. I could hit. We already have a call. I could hit it right now if I wanted to.
Let's just wait on that.
Okay.
Unless you want to talk to somebody if they're talking Hunger Games.
Well, we threw the number out. Do you want to? This could be the first call.
This could be the first call of all time for the Schmoes Up podcast, but it's got
to
be about Gary Ross and the Hunger Games. If it's not,
we're going to hang up.
We're
going to
hang up. No,
we
won't hang up.
Who do you got? All right, who do you got? Hello, you are on live with the Schmoes. Let's talk Hunger Games.
It's Catherine Reitman.
Oh, look who it is. Catherine Reitman calls. What are you upset about? Mark went, what are you owing about?
No, that was an awe, like, oh, she's so cute and adorable that she called in to our very first podcast. Where are you, Catherine?
Guys, I'm sick as a dog. I couldn't go shoot today, and I'm in bed watching you on my computer, and you look so cute.
How adorable is that? It means so much to us that our lovely co-host, Catherine Reitman, actually is able to join us.
Well, she was a little under the weather last night, and I love that Catherine is basically playing hooky from work.
Right.
She's faking sick to stay in bed. You know how when you were a kid and you fake sick to watch cartoons? She's faking sick to watch the Schmoes.
Or she's...
That's the only way I roll.
She's taking off work to work, is what she's doing.
Right.
So, Catherine, real quick, did you hear...
I got a pack of Garfield comics to my left.
Perfect.
I got some shows waiting for me in the microwave. I got my big wool socks on. Things are looking good.
Sexy. Listen, so we were talking, I'm sure you just heard us. Who are you looking... Are you happy or about Gary Ross not coming back?
You know, it's a mixed bag. The guy's so talented, obviously. I mean, he's responsible, like I always say, for one of my dad's favorites, Dave. The problem is that he missed something massive with this film,
as I
know we all agree with.
Yep.
And I think there's an opportunity now. Like, even though it's like, oh man, yeah, he was so close to the story and he's such a good filmmaker, but I think like a little kindle has been lit in a fireplace. Like, there's a potential here for someone to step in and just kick massive ass.
I agree. Who do you have a first choice?
For Katniss Everdeen, yes. Catherine Reitman.
Oh, yes. No, well, if you couldn't go back within the DeLorean and recast Katniss, who would you instead? Who would you have as a director for the next film?
Oh, man, I haven't really thought about it, but I'd love... I think I heard you talk about, what's his name, who took over on the Harry Potter and just brought this, like, dark element. Who's the third picture?
Alfonso Cuarón.
Yeah, like, I'd love that kind of take on it.
Yeah,
really
I think so,
dark
too.
Dark and gritty. Well, and we all know, Mark, that Kristian has a massive problem with the PG-13 situation.
Beyond.
But someone who could dance the line.
That ain't going anywhere. It's going to be rated PG-13, and that's why I kind of feel bad for Gary Ross with the shaky cam stuff. I don't blame him a lot. He's like, look, this is as violent as we can get, kids. It's PG-13.
You can show violence without making me sick. I mean, come on. There's other ways to do it. There's other ways to do it. But I agree with you. You're not getting past that R. It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
But,
you can still do a lot. You know, I think we can all agree on that. I think you can still... And fuck that. You can recast PETA.
Well, that's that... Yeah, I'm sure you can. Mark knows the rules better than I do. On that,
you didn't like PETA?
No, cursing.
PETA. Oh yeah. Swear your ass off, sweetie.
Nice. Look at that, Ellis going all.
I like when Catherine talks dirty in bed.
Look at you. Wow.
With wool socks on.
Get to a Toadhop network and the real feelings come out. Way to go, dirtbag.
There's nothing screams sexy like wool socks. You know.
Yeah.
It's like a porno in the radio days.
Dribbling cheese all over the sheets.
Hey, let's listen to a fireside chat and have a couple of mint juleps.
I've got two shih tzus in my lap.
Wow, this is. Well, I can't. Phil's probably running to get home right now.
Aroused.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, that's it. Again, like we said, it's not going to be a full Hunger Games thing, but there's other news out there, Catherine. I know that you haven't seen it yet, but one of the things Mark and I wanted to talk about today was how cool, and we're not going to give spoilers away, we saw the latest, the Joss Whedon-produced Cabin in the Woods.
Yeah.
And now, you see this trailer, and, well, there's some trailers that you see. If you watch the trailer, it gives away a little too much, some of it.
Here's the problem with Cabin in the Woods, is that it is not your normal teenagers go camping and get slashed horror movie. And so they want to, it's a really tough thing for advertisers, because they're like, we don't want to make everybody think it's just another one of those movies, but we don't want to give too much of the twist away, so you want to make it look like there's other things happening. Catherine, what is your, since you haven't seen or heard of, like, Cabin in the Woods as far, you haven't been in the theater to watch it, what's your take on it? As somebody who hasn't seen it.
I know you guys enjoyed it. I'm not a horror movie chick. I review them because I know a lot of the fans go crazy for that kind of thing. There's such a cult following for movies like this. for me, it's like exactly like you said. It looks like another. I'm gonna go upstairs in a light white tank top, and my nipples are protruding, and I'm gonna get stabbed to death. It doesn't look like something that's gonna get me crazy.
See, I love that because it's a double-edged sword because that's the way I want most people to go into that movie.
Yeah, but if that's their mentality, most people aren't going into
right.
the movie.
And the thing is, I get bored with those type of horror movies.
You and Catherine get scared watching horror movies.
False. It's
and what's wrong with that, Mark? What's wrong with that?
Catherine likes to grab onto the seat and scare the hell out of the people next to her when she sees the movies. But
yeah.
But the thing is, it's not that type of movie at all. It is, and Joss Whedon really adds something new to it.
Is it a comedy?
There are a lot of comedic elements to it.
There's parts that are hilarious.
Did you ever see Evil Dead, the Sam Raimi series, the trilogy that he did?
No, but I know people are bananas for it.
Yeah, and you could tell that there was like this homage for it. Like it's the tone and the way that there was just something so fresh about it, and something so like you're entertained the whole way through. They play on the cliches, and you know it's kind of what Wes Craven did in the first Scream.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's a lot
right.
like that.
A lot
yeah.
of fun. You feel like you're at a party.
Oh, that's absolutely correct. You feel like you're at a party, and at the end, you feel like you're at a party that makes Project X look like a museum.
Yeah,
you know?
I can't wait until I want to do the podcast like in a couple weeks and talk about Cabin in the Woods and kind of give away some of the spoilers, just because there's a scene in Cabin in the Woods that is so cool to me, and all horror movie fans will appreciate this one scene. So I can't wait to talk about it, but I will. Alas,
oh
we don't
God.
Do spoilers.
I'm so pissed that I missed it now. It sounds like it was great.
Picked the wrong week to get six, sweetheart.
It's true. There's a lot of Star Wars references. Just kidding.
No. Star Wars references.
No.
And I'm out.
Yeah, see you later. Yeah, so that's another one. And then there's the other one that's coming out this weekend, which is The Three Stooges, which we all saw last night.
Yeah.
Now, this you know, our review for that has not come out yet. It'll be out probably the end of the week. But again, without...
I'm in a weird place right now because
yeah.
I walked into the Three Stooges.
Say that one more time.
I walked in there thinking I was gonna hate it, but I always go into these things with an open mind, and I gotta tell you, that movie surprised the hell out of me.
Well,
I laughed thoroughly throughout the Three Stooges. I just admitted that on the radio.
I won't go that far, but I will say that from seeing, I was like the pissed off like old grouchy man walking into it.
Yeah,
going you know like I don't understand why they didn't make it a biopic.
Catherine was with us last night and she was a little sick last night, and I said, why are you here? Just go home.
Right.
It's not worth it, kid. Get out.
Yeah.
Save yourself.
This is not going to help you out at all. But and I'm like, why are they doing these performances? It's like you can't emulate what the Stooges did back in the day. It's not going to work. And I'll tell you, like, I was expecting Jack and Jill.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't Jack and Jill. Like,
no.
Go ahead.
Have you ever seen one of those movies where, like, in our business, in movie reviewing,
yes.
I know sometimes we have to cut it right from the movie and go home and review it that night. I'm so glad I didn't, because this is one of those movies that actually sat on me overnight.
Right.
And I woke up feeling differently about it.
How do you feel now?
Well, I wanted to think it was harmless, but the truth is it's very harmful.
Harmful in what way?
Because this film, as Kristian was saying, as our grouchy father was saying, it is based on, you know, I think a lot of people like Kristian who grew up watching The Three Stooges, and it has this real fan base, or have high expectations on this film. Now, if this movie was about, you know, like Dumb and Dumber style, just about three random weirdos who are cracking jokes, and it's screwball, and it's physical. You know what? Harmless fun. It gets a couple laughs. The script makes absolutely zero sense. It's really, really silly. But you'll laugh. I laugh.
I think that...
Because it's taking the name of the Three Stooges,
yeah.
I think this movie is on troubly ground.
I was with you when I was walking into the theater, but now I kind of think that enough time has passed. I don't think that anybody's going to confuse these guys. I think it's still a Three Stooges cover band. But
that's exactly what it is.
Yeah, but it's
fun. I think that's perfectly said.
It's fun to watch, and I think the Farrelly brothers were the perfect choice to make this movie because if you look at what they've done well in the past, movies like Dumb and Dumber, it's a fish out of water kind of scenario, and these three guys going into the real world a couple times, it almost felt like the Brady Bunch movie or the Addams Family movie, where they had fun with how stupid the scenario was, and so that's why I think they were great choices.
That's such a great point. You can literally feel how much fun they're having.
Yeah,
that's
like,
true.
A couple shots when he's like, gentlemen, and the three of them look behind them.
They they had a blast.
I can't imagine how much fun they had on set.
They definitely had a blast doing it. And like you said, cover band, you could have, like, if we were walking up here to Toadhop today at Universal City Walk and they were performing the same sketches they were doing last night in the movie, like, on near the fountain out there, I would be like, oh, yeah, I understand that. But it's the thing was, when I saw...
Have you ever seen Beetlejuice at Universal City Walk? That's not up to par. Like, these guys are really... This was a good cover band.
Yeah.
I've seen bad cover bands in my day.
I agree with you. And the thing was, and I went in there wanting to hate Sean Hayes for playing Curly.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, there's no way he's going to pull off Curly. He was the best.
Yeah.
He was the best.
Fantastic.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But you know what? Using the cover band analogy, you got to go with this. How good was the original band?
Okay? Right.
So
exactly.
A lot of people love the Three Stooges, and that's all good.
Yeah, it's like, if you want to...
You can't control what makes people laugh. If that's your thing, that's your thing.
Yeah, if you want to go see Led Zeppelin, sorry. The Led Zeppelin's not around anymore. So you can go see Led Zepp again at the House of Blues, and, you know, maybe you can trick yourself. That's how I watch a cover band, by the way, is it takes me like a good 5 minutes to just get over the silliness of these people on stage who are pretending to be somebody else. The other genius thing that the Three Stooges did was the movie opens, without giving it away who it is, there's two of the biggest stars in the comedy universe right now, and it, right away it kind of legitimizes this movie, because you see, oh wait, that person's willing to do a role in this movie, that person's doing a role in this movie,
yes,
maybe there is something to this.
Absolutely. And that starts in like the opening scene.
Yeah.
And it's
a perfect pace to get you in, to get you caught up to the Three Stooges as adults. So
now, is that a spoiler? Can we say who it is, or is that
I don't think that we should.
I think it's a spoiler.
I don't think that
I won't, but I'll say this. I think he definitely got some laughs. Guys, I'm getting another call. I can't be on this whole day. He got some laughs, but he kind of drove me crazy. I kind of wasn't sold on that guy.
In the beginning, I would not agree. At the end, I would agree. So, I mean, I think that...
A little played out. I mean, the movie gets tired. You can only watch the Stooges. Even the original Stooges, you can only watch them for so long.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I think for the first half an hour...
It's hard to maintain a full hour of entertainment like what the schmoes do.
That's true. And Reitman. Featuring Katherine Reitman. Now, they actually, like I said, the first half an hour, 40 minutes, I'm in it, and then it gets a little redundant, but I do think kids will like it. But again, wait for all three of our reviews. Katherine's will be up on Friday on her YouTube channel, BID. Ours will be up probably tomorrow.
Yep.
And then one other thing that this kind of movie news that's coming out, and that would be the Avengers screening. The Avengers.
Are we going to see it?
No, because we're going to see the movie, but we're not seeing it as soon as a lot of other people are. They're doing like these fan screenings now,
people
are seeing them like tomorrow and today. And
oh,
next
really?
Week. Oh, and people are
the
going,
Avengers.
Yes. Look at Mark. Mark just turned into a 4-year-old.
Not like a cover band Avengers. Not like guys that you hire to show up for your birthday party. Sean, like the actual Avengers.
Yeah, Sean Hayes is not playing Iron Man.
Oh my goodness!
Wait, hold up, Kristian. Do you know if? Because a lot of these early fan screenings is actually, they continue to change the film. Do you know if this is a completed
It's got to be. What are they going to change within, I mean, the premiere is next week.
Okay. Yeah, no, it's ready.
It's ready to go. And from what I hear is that people are really excited about it and that it's pretty damn good.
You've heard reviews already
of
people who've seen it?
I've heard some friends that we know that have told me that they've seen it and it's pretty damn good.
Okay. Catherine, I have a weird sneaking suspicion that Christian's already seen the Avengers twice. And he's just teasing us with it.
No, trust me.
Mark, are you out of your mind? If Kristian saw it, he would be talking about it nonstop. He'd be rubbing it in our faces every
true.
Time. Got.
That's true. I would be the Tony Stark to your Incredible Hulk, Catherine.
That's right. Well,
well said.
This is my Hunger Games. I already read the book.
What was it, episode 4? And then I have gotten word also that we're going to be joined with Jay Harrington.
Jay Harrington is going to be back on our second half of this podcast. We take a break in a couple minutes.
Yeah.
But let's get some thoughts out about Avengers real quick. Are we looking forward to it? Now, I was upset when I saw the last trailer. Not because it didn't look awesome, but I thought they gave away too much.
For the Avengers? Yeah.
So, Catherine, your take as a female who's sick in bed, who still wears wool socks, who's probably enjoying a nice phosphate right now. How do you feel about the Avengers? Are you excited at all?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I've never read the comic books. I've watched all the films with the characters that are going to be in this film. So that's really my only claim to knowledge on this movie. I'm excited because the fans are excited.
Right.
Like, you know, I might not be as knowledgeable on the tale and all the details of the story, But whenever a crowd gets excited about something, you want to be a part of it. You want to feel the buzz.
It's an event. It's like that's how I felt when I was sitting with you nerds at the Hunger Games, is that everybody in the theater, and it was a press screening, so it's a lot of critics and stuff, a lot of, you know, normally people who don't get excited about anything in life. And there was a buzz. Yeah. There was a palpable buzz in the room.
It felt like a sports event, right?
Yeah.
A big fight. And I think that's, the Avengers, I think it's going to be 10 times that for the Avengers because...
I'm dressing up.
I'm nervous. I'm fucking nervous because I feel like because there's so much buzz, there's so much anticipation... And there's so many divas on set, there's so many famous people. I'm concerned that they're going to make this a sellout film, and it's just going to be a lot of, like... I just don't want it to Michael Bay on me, you know? I want it to feel real, or real, as real as something like this.
Right. As real as this.
Yeah, you got to have a real feel to it.
Speaking of divas, I'd like to thank Catherine Reitman for joining us. Catherine, we got to go to break right now, sweetheart. And when we come back on the Schmoes Know podcast...
Yeah.
You guys, check out Breaking It Down on iTunes. We're officially a podcast on iTunes.
Awesome.
We're ranked number 33 currently out of 200, which I cannot believe. So check us out, comment, and rate us if you don't mind.
Catherine Reitman from Breaking It Down on iTunes. We'll be right back on the Schmoes Know podcast.
You're listening to the Toadhop Network, radio worth watching.
Don't we all, Kiss? Don't we all want to rock and roll all night, party every day? And it is a party here at the Schmoes Know Movies podcast on the Toadhop Network. Welcome back to the show, joined by Kristian Harloff, as always, my fellow Schmo. And Kristian, we have someone else in the studio, a very special guest. Very special guest, ooh. Jay Harrington.
That's right.
From the new film in theaters now, American Reunion, amongst many projects.
The number one comedy in America, mind you.
And the world.
Is it the world?
Yeah,
great.
It did pretty well.
It did good. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
Very cool. I mean,
you're going up against the Hunger Games, so it's so tough to beat that.
Right.
To be number one in the box office with a phenomenon like that. But American Reunion did very well, and I actually like the movie. I think it's probably not the first American Pie for me, but it's like right after that one. I think it was better than Two, better than Wedding.
Yeah.
And how does it feel for somebody like you to come into a movie like that where there's an established cast, you know, it's a bunch of dudes, and then you're kind of, you come in, is that more pressure on you?
No, I think also because of the nature of the movie itself, everyone's grown up a little bit, so maybe if it was coming into the second one, you know, and being a fellow 27-year-old to their 20-year-old, maybe then it would have been, I mean, I don't know, I'm just saying, but everyone's grown up and having a nice time getting back together, truly in a sense of a reunion.
Yeah, so I mean, it worked because Chris Klein wasn't actually back for, and I know because he makes reference in it in the movie, that he wasn't in American Wedding, right?
He did. He says that line, you know, I missed your wedding, wasn't going to miss this.
Right. So, I mean, that was the thing, too. I don't know if you saw our review or not, but we had mentioned one of the things.
Just say yes. Please say yes.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you very much.
My brother sent it to
me. Because one of the things, and we had said this, too, and it was genuine from the fact, one of the great things about the American Pie movies was that they introduced these kind of characters that, yeah, they had their, your main guys like your Stiflers and stuff too, but what they had was in the first one, like John Cho was stuck out with the MILF line, and we thought that you were definitely the person in this movie that did that.
Thank you.
Because some of the lines, this is the lines at the beach with the, you know, it's not really, there's a conversation that Jay has with Chris on the beach that's, it could have been beyond silly, but Jay played it in a way that it was like, it worked, and these little subtle like looks that made it, the scene really funny.
Yeah, are you talking about the nighttime?
Yeah, at the party. Yeah, yeah. So you know that one scene towards the end there, and I and that was like okay, so that stuck out for me. So I mean, I thought you did a phenomenal job.
Thank you.
Yeah,
the directors were so great, but they were very they had their broad comedy, they had their big you know moments in the movie. So they wanted
guys crapping in coolers.
Yeah, exactly. Right, so yeah. They just wanted it to be pretty. Even keel it, you didn't know.
Perfect.
So that the payoff works, because there was concern when they first saw it. Will people care when Stifler punches me out? I mean, because
yeah,
there's so many storylines going on
right.
with the main characters that will this even play?
Right.
So you play it as he's just a guy. He could be a dick. He then you know reveals himself at the beach. That he is kind of, but it's still like, wait, is he a jerk? Or
to your credit, I didn't think you were a dick the first time you showed up on screen.
No,
you probably get that a lot when you're out. You know, I didn't know you were a dick.
Well, this was the great thing, though, because one of the directors...
I don't hide it as well.
Right. Well, John Hurwitz, yeah. who was one of the directors, we were back and forth tweeting, and we had mentioned that you were coming on the podcast, too, and he said... Jay was one of the big surprises of the
absolutely
how much because of how he played it off, you know, such a nice guy being able to play such a dick, and you know and I've known Jay for a handful of years. He is a really nice guy, but one of the things I got to ask you though too, are you single?
No, I'm not.
Oh, you're not. So it's not going to work with the Mina Savari thing. I was going to say, because Mina Savari, I heard broke up. I was going to say, if there was any on-screen romance, we'll go right to the heart on this one, too.
Dude, you were...
I was going for it. Yeah. I was going for it, but he's not single, so it doesn't work.
If you're
work.
A future guest, listen to this episode, because that's how
Kristian
does
I'll go
it.
Right after
he
you.
Sets you up.
I set you
like,
up.
Hey, Jay, you were such a nice
so
guy,
good.
Man. I mean, you're really just
right,
cool.
You got to massage it. Yeah. You got to massage it. But yeah. But he knew it was coming, and he went, boom, and he blocked it out. So
you're a nice guy. Who are you banging right now?
That's right. Who any nonsense going on? Was there really any cup stuff going on?
Oh, my God.
The first one, come on, we got to get nasty. It's American Pie.
And Howard Stern.
There was a lot. I just going back to what you were saying, but there was a line that unfortunately was cut, and there was a lot of stuff that was cut. They had this huge epic on their hands, and they had to get it down to a good time.
Right.
But it was something when I first met Oz, as I said, you know, come on, you were on that TV show, that dancing show. That's pretty good. You beat Urkel, huh? And he says, no, it was actually. You saw, you know, and then he deflects it. But that was the irony is we had no idea that. He was going to be on Dancing with the Stars, and it would have worked great.
Yeah, it would have been great. That's right.
Oh, Jaleel White
he's
on
right
is on
now,
it.
And he's kicking ass.
And we just—that was just a line.
Oh shoot! Look at that.
What's weird is that Urkel's name rolls off my tongue that quickly. I'm like, oh, Jaleel White, really?
What do you mean? What's weird? You going back and you're going to watch the first season or whatever that
kind
thing
of? A, I may have had a few Urkel posters in my room. Kind of a big fan.
So Jay, take us through a process as far as like, so when you hear that you know you're going to get you got the audition for American Reunion.
Yeah.
You know so. You know, you go through the first initial rounds or whatever, too, but when it finally gets down to it, when you're like, okay, you're auditioning for both John and Hayden?
No, and at this point, you know, they were already in Atlanta shooting, so they were up against it, and they had seen a lot of people, and I went in, and the timing, it was all kismet. I mean, I think that they were, they needed somebody that everyone could agree to, but at the same time, they were already in production. So it worked out well for me because I didn't have to go through a huge process. And I think having previous credits might have helped in that sense that they could look at stuff and say, oh yeah, well yeah, we know who that guy is. But
well, did they ever see Better Off Ted? Did they see that?
Yes.
Okay.
And I'm sure that was part. You know that yeah. But what that was fun was to sort of be that guy for three quarters of it and then turn into just
right.
this.
Well, that's a question too. Can you get because for those of you guys who haven't seen Better Off Ted, it was a TV show that was on. It had one or two seasons.
Well, we had two half seasons. We did 26 episodes,
okay.
which you know in the UK is you're on the air forever.
Right. Well, that's and it was with Jay. It was Portia de Rossi, and it was a really funny show. And I will say it was criminally underwatched because my wife and I watched it for a while. And then you know they what. From seeing that show and getting that tone from you, you can definitely see where the comedy chops. You can say, "Oh well, I feel comfortable with this guy for sure." Let's have him in there to go one on one with Stifler. Let's have him go one on one with Chris. So
maybe that was it.
Yeah.
So if you're auditioning for a role in a future American movie, it's good to have been on a TV show for a couple of years.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Well, I think so, because you said, you weren't really nervous going into it, right?
Well, there I was once I got there. I mean, yeah, certainly, because these guys were something. You know, I'm a little bit older, but I in 1999, I mean, I went to the theaters to see American Pie.
Yeah.
So
that's cool.
That was a pretty big finale. In 99, that was a pretty big deal, because you didn't get a real good a teenage movie that was that raunchy since really like Porky's, right?
Exactly.
Porky's was
a beta.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. I was in sixth grade, and my parents left for the weekend. We convinced our babysitter for the weekend to let us rent Porky's just to shut us up, and my life was changed forever.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm still waiting to meet a girl named Cherry forever. I still haven't met her yet.
Well, mentioning Porky's and movies like that, it kind of segues us into what we wanted to talk about today, and it was the great party movies. You know, there's so many of them, and then we do a show on movies.com to where we did like the top five high school party movies. But I thought, you know, there's so many more besides just the high school movies, and that's why I think what's great about talking about American Pie is, yes, it started off in high school, but by the time we talk about this film,
yeah,
they're, you know, in their 30s, and so there are a lot of movies out there that
there's a ton of great party movies, great party scenes, and if you're listening right now, we want you to call in and weigh in, talk to Jay, say hi to us, and tell us what is your favorite party movie scene of all time. And the number to call is 888-520-4374. Give us a ring here, and I guess, you came up with the idea, right?
Yeah,
so kick us off.
I have to say, one of my favorite party movies, because there's so many different scenes, you got to go Bachelor Party. With Tom Hanks.
With Tom Hanks and a young Barry Diamond.
And a cocaine out donkey.
Yeah.
I mean,
Adrian's bed.
That's right.
Adrian's bed.
That's right.
Was his wingman.
Yeah. And that's funny. I totally forgot about that.
Bachelor Party I saw it recently, and it's like, yeah, Tom Hanks is fun to watch.
Oh, come on.
The movie as a whole.
It's an 80s movie. Any movies you go back, it's like when you watch Flash Gordon again.
That's,
it doesn't have the same tone.
Can you do that movie now, though?
Well, I think they did a Hangover.
All the stuff they did in that but in that party, I mean, they're doing.
There's some dirty,
heavy drugs,
dirty shit. Right. Yeah.
Dirty, yeah. Can you make that now?
I mean, I think you can. I don't know how big commercially it was, because I mean, there was that movie that came out, Very Bad Things, like about 10 years ago. That they kind of did a different version of it. It was a little more raw, more of a dramedy, I guess, than anything else. Because you had what's his name, Jeremy Piven, and I mean, that was a crazy movie. So I don't even know if you consider that a party movie as much as it's like a cover-up movie.
Yeah, because there's a lot of other stuff going on. Yeah,
but yes, I think you could. I mean, that's the thing is, I think, and this is a conversation we've had a couple times on this podcast, but I think you can pretty much do any subject matter if you have the right director, if you have the right writer. It's like George Carlin used to say about you know, jokes. Anything is funny if it's done and told the right way by the right person.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's the same with subject matter as far as, you know, Bachelor Party. Could they do it? Sure. 10, you know, maybe 9 out of 10 directors are going to F it up, but there's that one guy out there that's going to make it work.
Well, I'm glad you opened with Bachelor Party, because it's not like impossible to follow.
Yeah.
It's a good opening act.
Yeah.
And we have a caller on.
It's
got Party in the title, so it's a nice kind of welcome.
Works.
It's the appetizer.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're going to take a call from Tyler, the Cali Critics.
Oh,
you guys
great.
Will know. Tyler, what's up, dude?
You there, Tyler?
There we go. Hey, Tyler, what's up, buddy?
Nope.
First time, long time.
That's it. long time. Well, hopefully we get Tyler back. We lost him. We got him, Tyler?
Yeah.
Hey, there he is. What's up, buddy? How are you?
Doing pretty good. Good tuning in. This is a great new layout that you got for the podcast.
Thank you very much, man. Thanks for joining us. Tyler, Cali Critic, is also a reviewer on YouTube. You should check him out, man. So we're here. We're joined with Jay Harrington. Did you see American Reunion, Tyler?
Yes, I did. I loved it. And it was even better than that. I got to experience it with a college crowd, too.
Oh, right. Yeah, I'm sure.
Where'd you see it?
Where I see it? Oh, it was on my college campus at UCI. They screened it 2 weeks early.
Oh, nice.
He's just rubbing it in that he's still in college.
Yeah, yeah.
And he can see. I want you to take advantage of the position you're in, because you get to see a great movie about people partying, and then you can go out and play beer pong and stuff. Guys like, we got to go home. We have to take our Metamucil.
Right.
I got to get up early to watch the Masters the next day. It's a full schedule that I have.
Yeah, I guess you do. And also, I hate to rub it in more, but I remember that thing that you were talking about, the Avengers, earlier, too. I'm one of those lucky people that are actually seeing it.
Son of a bitch.
You've seen the Avengers already?
Yeah, I managed to snag a reservation for the San Diego one on Saturday.
So you're seeing it this Saturday?
Yeah.
Okay, you haven't seen it yet. All right. So, all right. We don't hate you yet. We'll hate you on Saturday.
While we got you on the line, Tyler, what's one of your favorite party movies? Why don't we go there?
You know, I haven't really seen too many, like, really big party movies in particular. Like, I still feel bad for not seeing Animal House in its entirety, but I saw the last half and loved that for the most part. I'd say probably Superbad right now.
Superbad's a good one.
Superbad's a good one. You got to go see, like, seriously, don't go to class today. Watch Animal House. Watch the entire thing all the way through. It's maybe the funniest film ever made.
Yeah, and then do you have anything for Jay before we're going to move on to another movie, but just want to see if you want one more question for Jay.
Yeah, what was it like working with John Hurwitz and Hayden Schlossberg for this?
They were great. You know, they're two guys that have known each other since high school, so it was a very relaxed, fun atmosphere, and you know, everybody knew what we were doing. We weren't shooting some epic, you know, turn of the century, right. Jane Eyre. It was American Pie. So they were very, you know, that helped. That's going back to what you were saying. It was a very relaxed atmosphere, and they're both a lot of fun.
Cool. Well, and thank you, Tyler, for the phone call, the Cali Critic.
And
imagine when you're making a comedy like that, you don't want everybody to be too stressed out.
Right.
You know, I mean, you're on set, it's long days, you want to have a nice, relaxed atmosphere.
Yeah, you know what was cool also is that the fact that they were coming off of Harold and Kumar's Christmas, too, which, by the way,
one of the best uses of 3D I've ever seen was Harold and Kumar's
absolutely.
Christmas.
Absolutely.
Pot smoke coming right in your face.
It's one of those things, because John Hurwitz is going to come on the podcast, when we talk to him, I definitely want to talk about that.
Oh, I'll have to wear my tux that day.
Please do. But not the one with the shirt, the actual tux.
Fine. I'll have to talk to the cleaners.
God, those poor people. Now, the thing with those movies, like, I loved the first movie. I thought it was very original, it was raw. And the second one, I thought they were rushed. I think the studio rushed them into doing a second one, and I didn't really love it. And I was like, okay. So when the third one came in, I'm like, what are we going to do here? And I enjoyed the hell out of it because of the same type of thing they did with American Reunion, is that they know what they had, and they went boom, boom, and they just kept hitting like this. It was over the top. They knew what they were going to be. And I said this in the review. I thought that the first half of American Reunion maybe suffered from the Harold and Kumar tone, but then they got right back into what we were all about in American.
It felt like I was watching an American Pie movie, particularly you know, actually, when, not to kiss our guest's ass, but once he starts, you know, once he's in the movie, then it's not all your credit. So I don't want you I want you driving home thinking, oh yeah, I totally own that. But it was then it really settled into a nice pace. And again, Eugene Levy is just
That's what I wanted to ask you.
Did you have any scenes with Levy? Did you get to hang out?
Did you get to meet him?
I met him my first day on the set at lunch, and he.
Yeah, nice guy.
He's a very nice guy, yeah.
Dude, that's the scenes he kills. I want to see a full movie about Jim's dad.
Yeah.
I want to see a full movie. I mean,
he
that's...
He plays drunk. I tweeted this the other day about Jake Johnson from New Girl, who also, I don't know if you guys watch that show.
I do.
He plays drunk extraordinarily well, too. The two of them together would be fun to watch.
Amazing. Like, that scene... At the party with him, like the drunk scene is amazing, and then the scene with him in the theater was still for his mom.
But also the scenes where the moments that this is why I was a big fan of the movie from the inception, from the script, was there are moments, and I read some stuff where people kind of ragged on this, but there was heart, and you need a little heart to, I think.
Oh yeah,
and I think that was the thing.
Moments that of, you know, missing his wife, and they were just so subtle and so well played that it made the payoff of him going to get drunk that much funnier.
People had a problem with the heart.
I'd read, like, oh, really? Enough. Like, well, like, you need that.
I would like to see
it's
more.
A fair point, because if you talk about all-time party movies, where is there really a lot of heart? Because there's not really a lot of heart in Animal House.
Right.
But it's so damn
you really care about
funny.
The, yeah, you care
you
about,
care
the
about him. Just, why? That's a good question. Why do we care so much about Bluto? Why do we care so much about those, about Pinto and... Well, with Pinto, because we've all been there. We've all been the guy.
Well, my party, my favorite, because you said scene too, but I think is up there, is Weird Science, because
yeah,
it's the two
of
guys.
Of course, yeah.
They're nerds, and so you feel there's heart there because you feel for them, and then they get this epic party, and then these horrible people come from the third dimension.
Right.
And then the the payoff for that is how. You know, he says, "I'm so sorry." You know, the big ugly ogre, and you have a beautiful home.
Yeah,
and that's a classic scene that is because it's you care for these kids.
Yeah,
they got picked on, and now they get to be the.
Well, I mean, and that's the thing where you have to have a good development to why the party is happening and why you care about the party. And I think that's what a lot of people had the problem with Project X. I happened to just shut my brain off and watch the movie, and I enjoyed it. But a lot of people disliked that movie. And I actually talked to somebody last night. Who their biggest problem was the fact that you didn't care about any of the characters whatsoever. It was just a kind of just chaos, and they didn't give a shit. They didn't like any of the characters, and that's like what Jay was saying. You have to really care, and I think one of the movie's party scenes that you really care about for me is Say Anything.
Oh, yeah.
Like when, when what's his face? Jeremy Piven is drunk off his ass. Talk about somebody who can play drunk
you
well.
You must chill.
You must chill. You must chill. It's like when you take Ellis to Qdoba. Like, you
know, yeah, I get excited for Mexican food. Yeah, you I don't play drunk chill. Well, but I drink well.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's, so I think that's another movie. And again, for you guys out there who had not seen these movies, we're talking about Weird Science and Say Any, you'll Say Anything, I guess, one too. But you should, these are the movies that you should definitely see.
Yeah, I'll update a little bit. I'll get into the 90s, into the mid 90s with the song. Actually, the song that we had break with was Rock and Roll All Night, and that's a classic, classic soundtrack to a classic party movie, Dazed and Confused.
Absolutely,
it's because that whole movie is it's a bunch of mini parties leading up to this one big blowout at the Moon Tower, and then you get to the Moon Tower, and that's when the heart of that movie really comes out, is when the keg is tapped and they play Tuesday's Gone, and we realize this is what we're doing with our summer.
Right.
But it's going to be so much fun.
And I thought it was so realistic too, like when you like just the way it was all set up. And you had the
how there really are 30-year-old construction workers that hit on high school girls. That is very, very realistic.
Absolutely. But just like the stereotypes, the way that they hit it, it wasn't too over the top of the stereotypes, and just the way it, like you said.
And it was the journey to the Moon Towers.
Yep.
See, what we had growing up, what kids don't have now, I think, is that the lead to the big party. You got to go to the gas station. What's going on tonight? Where are we going?
Right.
Well, I heard that there's a party there. All right, and then you get in your car. There's no texting. There's no instant, where's everybody?
You got to work for it.
You had to work for it.
It's rumors. It's hearsay.
And you ended up having actually more fun on the way.
Right.
When you got to the real party, it was like, it wasn't as fun as the 2 hours we just spent.
Yeah, absolutely. And you kids today, I'm sorry, you're never going to get that chance again. Luckily, you have internet porn to look at by the time you're 5 years old, so
right.
That's
got,
fine.
You got another caller?
We got a call. Yeah, we got another buddy, Victor Dos Santos. Victor, how are you, dude?
You there, Vic?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, hey. That was better. We're getting better at answering the phone.
This is a new thing. Victor, how are you? The frickin' film critic. What's up, buddy?
Not too much. I saw you had Jay Harrington on. I'm a huge fan of Better Off Ted.
Oh, thanks, bud.
So I wanted to say, I wish that show had gone on longer, but you did a great job.
Oh, thank you very much.
Victor, now you're a big film guy. Do you have any movie party scenes that maybe we missed that we haven't talked about so far?
Well, I haven't been listening to the show.
Okay.
Well, thank you, Victor. Thanks for supporting
since
our podcast.
Jay Harrington's like, I must call Jay. Screw the schmoes.
But did you already mention the super bad party scene?
Briefly.
We didn't really get into the party scene, but yeah, that's another one where you get there and getting to the party is so much more fun than when you actually get, for those kids, when you actually get to the party.
Absolutely, but it's so funny, though, too, because you talk to the old farts at the table here, and we're mentioning, you know, Bachelor Party and Dazed and Confused, and then the two kids that call up both mention super bad.
You youngsters with your super bad.
That's Joni Hill. He's ancient.
Well, I really enjoyed when Seth Rogen and Bill Hader crashed the party, and then they started to just dance after a while.
Right.
Yeah, let me tell you, growing up in Williamsburg, Virginia, that's exactly how cops around there act. They just they crash the party, and they take the good beer. They'll let you keep the case of Natty Light, but they'll take the Amstels.
That's right.
Well, cool, Victor. Thanks. It's good talking to you, buddy. Thanks for calling the podcast. Maybe even listen next week. Who knows?
Yeah,
maybe
who
you
knows?
Roll the dice.
I might just do that.
Appreciate that.
Thanks, dude. I appreciate it, man.
All right, bye.
Okay. Yes, I mean, I think those are the majority of, like, the real, I mean, and then you could go back high school movies and you go a little, you know, maybe, like, I think it was late 90s was Can't Hardly Wait, you know, the Jennifer Love Hewitt, where that entire film was a party.
It was a party, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, and I like movies like that to where they're surprising, like, when you know, you think there's just going to be that kind of teeny bopper thing, but there's heart,
yep.
Like you said before. I mean, you have to, in order to make a good movie with a party, you got to have heart.
All right, well, let me put the pressure on our next caller, because you mentioned Can't Hardly Wait, starring Jennifer Love Hewitt. Our next caller is a huge fan of Jennifer Love Hewitt. Her name is Brianne, better known as Miss Movies. Miss Movies, welcome to the Schmoes Know podcast. We're talking about Can't Hardly Wait. Why do you love Can't Hardly Wait so much?
Well, we know it's because I have a big crush on Jennifer Love Hewitt. I mean, obviously.
Which no guy on this table is going to complain about. That's not what we...
Especially after Client List. Are you kidding me?
Totally. What is that show, Client List? I'm driving around Los Angeles.
Who cares?
I see these billboards. It's Jennifer Love Hewitt in a trench coat and nothing else.
Right.
What is the show?
Well, she's like a...
She's got to pay the bills.
But yeah, she's like a house mom. Sorry. Go ahead, Brianne.
All I know is she's a massage therapist that has to pay the bills, so she's got to do a little extra now.
Oh, all right.
A little extra.
Ellis just T-voted in his mind.
That's right. So it's kind of like the female hung, which is just she gives hand jobs at the end of a massage.
Well,
let's call
spade a spade. But it was a TV movie that did really well for them and Lifetime, and so they made it a show.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So, okay, let's talk Can't Hardly Wait and not our dirty fantasies.
What's so good about that movie, Brianne?
Okay, what I like most about it is the running gags throughout the film. So mm-hmm. I think my favorite is like the band Love Burger and how they never play.
Right.
But then they're talking about how they're going to like get back together at the end and they're going to do some hits and, you know, some new stuff. And I just think that's hilarious.
Yeah, and that was a nice callback in that to Clueless because it's some of the Clueless guys.
It's Breckenmeyer.
Yeah. It's Breckenmeyer, isn't it? And it is, it's, I thought it was more of the guys from Clueless too, Breckenmeyer or somebody else. But yeah, and that I guess would also tie into Clueless. There's a lot of party scenes in that movie.
Yeah,
as
but
well.
I got a bone to pick with Can't Hardly Wait. It's because the kid's drinking and he hears Paradise City. He's like, I remember this song. What do you mean you remember this song? It's better than 1987 when it came out. It's an all time classic. You don't remember that. You just experience it.
I can understand the frustration.
Well, he was drunk.
Well, that's true too.
That was the first time he was drunk. Cut him some slack, all right?
Oh, fine. Well, thank you for the call, Brand. You want to say hi to Jay? Do you have any questions for Jay real quick?
Hey, Jay.
How you doing?
I don't have any questions.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Jay.
That's okay. Because I have questions for you.
Good job.
Oh, no,
thank you, Brianne. Thanks for calling.
All right. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay.
And check us out on we're on the Miss Movies podcast this week, too.
Oh, so, yeah. We are. That's true.
Now, that's a good question real quick. If we can get really personal here. Do you guys remember the first time you were drunk at a party?
Yeah, I do actually. It wasn't a party though. I mean, it kind of was. I lived in Queens, so like
Well, Queens, as from what I've read in the trades, is one big party.
Listen, I was 15 years old, and like my neighbor who was like probably 40, 45, and I thought he was cool, but at the time thinking back at it, what a dirtbag. 40, 45, I don't know.
Does this end with like a van and some Charleston chews and a story?
But I'm 15 when the guy's 45, he's buying, he's like, yeah, go, here's, he just bought us all beer, went to, and just, you think, I mean, it's a cool motion, but he shouldn't have been doing it at 15 years old. And then I remember just being shit canned at a park, if you call that a party, a bunch of crappy kids running around inside of a basketball court.
That's totally a party.
I guess. And then all I know is that I was upside down in the stickball court, like, you know, trying to figure out, people going, here, drink coffee. I didn't drink coffee, I didn't drink Coors Light. It was disgusting. It was a terrible for
What about you? Where do you grow up, Jack?
Outside of Boston.
And oh, that so, which the Patriots hat. Yes. Should have given
he did
you
that.
Away.
He did that to spite me.
So, but it was Cape Cod, similar thing. You know, not at a party, but with some friends.
Okay, all right, yeah. Just
not
a,
good.
No,
not
good. No. And then everyone the first time ends up like the kid from Paradise City.
Made me not want to, and I didn't drink for a long time.
Yeah.
All through high school because I just didn't have a good experience.
See, but that's and that kind of is I have a daughter now and that kind of makes me think I kind of want her to get that shit faced the first time that she gets shit faced.
What a great father you are!
Because maybe she goes through what Jay went through and she doesn't want to drink for a while and then she studies, does her things, and doesn't become client list.
A bunch of. Yeah, you want to keep. It used to be you want to keep your daughter off the pole. Now you want to keep her off a billboard for a lifetime.
Yeah, right.
And that's what our basketball coach did. He caught a bunch of us drinking one time, and so he wanted to get a six pack and make us each chug it, and then we had to run laps the rest of practice.
Is that what?
So
you,
that's old school. That's old school basketball,
that's
right
like
there.
Caught with a cigarette.
Yeah, that's how you get.
Made to smoke them all.
That's right.
That's right. That's right. So what about Fat Ellis? When was the first time?
Fat Ellis. The first time he got drunk was at a college party. It was my last year of high school. We went to go visit my buddy's girlfriend at UVA, which is a great party campus, and it just hit me, and I was following around this girl. She liked me, and I was like, this is the best feeling ever. And that feeling hasn't left in 10 years.
Wow.
I've been drunk for 10 years.
So that's my point. See what I'm saying? Like, so you and I had those experiences where we're so hammered we can wait, and we can kind of pace ourselves. This guy was doing Jack Daniels in the parking lot on the way to Terminator 2 ride today.
Wait, we're not going on a ride?
No.
We're here at Universal Studios. We can do anything we want. We're just going to podcast instead of go on the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids tour.
Right. Now... One of the things we do normally on the podcast, we're not going to do this week, but we'll return it next week, is the game.
Yeah,
which
really wanted to go against Harrington.
I know. Harrington is a movie aficionado, so we probably would have been pretty good. Basically, what the game is we play like these clips to where you would guess.
Oh yeah, sure.
Yeah. So next time you come back on, we'll play
tease.
For sure. It's a good tease. But I know that a lot of the fans are going to be saying, "Where's the game?" So the game's coming back next week, but. One of the things that Jay said, we caught him on the break, as we were talking, we did talk about the Avengers. We'll go back to that real quick. Jay, you said you're more of a DC guy than Marvel.
Yeah, I was a Batman guy, Superman, and I never got into the X-Men, never got into... I really enjoyed Iron Man and that movie, but I didn't know anything about it.
So are you looking more forward to Iron Man 3? Because Shane Black is directing now.
I guess, but I'm not against the. I'm not looking forward to the Avengers.
I want you protesting. I want you picketing outside in a Batman costume at the Avengers. Like, no, this is not the movie you should be seeing.
But it'll be. I think it'll be great, and with Robert Downey Jr. I just think they have a great cast assembled for. I hope it doesn't fail.
Right, I can't see it failing. No. I think there's too much of a base. But so you're more of a Dark Knight guy.
Yes.
Yeah. So while we have you on here, if we don't get you back before the actual The Dark Knight Rises come out, your thoughts on that? Are you excited? Yeah.
Very excited. I did not see the first 6 minutes, and I didn't do that for the other one either. I just wanted, on purpose. Yeah. I just want to see it because you know, in 1989 when Tim Burton's Batman came out.
Yeah.
I was so excited. I videotaped Entertainment Tonight when they had like a 2 minute coming up next.
Oh, yeah,
preview. And then what I did right before is I went to Newbery Comics and I bought the adapted novel of the screen before.
So you knew it. So you ruined it for yourself. Yeah, I did that for Rocky Balboa.
You did?
Yeah.
I did that for Booty Call. I read it way before. Yeah.
So I've just stayed out of it. Ain't a cool news. I've tried to not click on images. I've tried to just.
It's good.
Keep it real.
It's smart. Yeah. All right. So we are winding down here, guys. This was the first Schmoes No Podcast on the Toadhop Network. Super excited, Jay. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Check out American Reunion in theaters now.
Yeah, still downstairs.
You can see it here if you're a Universal.
That's right. And coming up next on the Toadhop Network, we have the Heidi and Frank Show, as always, at 10 a.m. So listen to Heidi and Frank. Enjoy them. And on behalf of Jay and Kristian Harloff, I'm Mark Ellis. Thank you, Ripped Apparel, for sponsoring us. Go to their website, movies.com. And I'm at Las Vegas this weekend at South Point Hotel and Casino.